Alleluia. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did through him among you, as you yourselves know, this man, handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand, so that I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope, for you will not abandon my soul to Hades, nor let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now we will say Psalm 16 in unison. Protect me, O God, for I take refuge in you. I have said to the Lord, you are my Lord, my good above all others. All my delight is upon the godly that are in the land, upon those who are noble among the people. But those who run after other gods still have their troubles multiplied. Their libations of blood I will not offer, nor take the names of their gods upon my lips. O Lord, you are my portion and my cup. It is you who uphold my lot. My boundaries enclose a pleasant land. Indeed, I have a goodly heritage. I will bless the Lord who gives me counsel. My heart teaches me night after night. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not fall. My heart, therefore, is glad, and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. For you will not abandon me to the grave, nor let your Holy One see the pit. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore.
A reading from the first letter of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of our souls. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Oh,
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who is called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written about in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of each heart be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Last week, we celebrated the marvelous mystery of Easter. Christ is risen. We say our alleluias again, and we rejoice. We've made it through the long, sometimes difficult journey of Lent. And of course, this year, Lent seemed longer and more difficult than any in recent memory. But Easter has arrived, and for a brief moment in time, we have suspended our doubts. We stopped trying to make all the pieces fit together, and we allowed ourselves to be lifted into the chorus of generations, singing, "He is risen." We always look forward to Easter. We anticipate the joy and relief of having made it through the wilderness of Lent. Now, I've seen a post on social media that says, "This is the Lentiest Lent I have ever Lented." Now, grammatically strange, yes, but I suspect we get the meaning. We've sacrificed and given up more than we could have ever imagined when we came together on that Ash Wednesday in February, just a couple of months ago. Yet here we are, we've made it to Easter, we've rejoiced, we've lived the assurance of God's promises once again. And even this quarantine and virus can't stop us from receiving God's love. Now, some of us watched this year's Easter services in our pajamas. Some of us tried to recreate this Easter in the image of what we normally do. And some of us relaxed into an Easter with few expectations. But we yearned to rejoice, to connect with our Christian siblings around the world, and to experience something that would give us hope for the future. And here we are starting the second week of the Easter season. We're still in quarantine. We're still at risk. And we're still suffering in all kinds of ways. What's going to happen next? How long will this threat last? How much more pain and loss will we have to endure? In today's reading from the Gospel of John, it seems likely that the disciples are asking these same questions. This is Jesus' first appearance to them since the resurrection. They're scared, they're hiding out, they've locked themselves in a room. They've witnessed what just happened to Jesus, their Lord. They know that the religious leaders and Roman rulers could do the same to them just for being associated with Jesus. But thankfully, Jesus knows God's children so well. He knows that they're scared and confused. So Jesus comes to them and he stands among them. Now he doesn't scold them for their fear or doubt. He knows their hearts and what they're going through. And he knows that they're in real danger. But Jesus reassures them. He comforts them. He meets them where they are. Jesus greets them with peace. Peace be with you. Their teacher, their Lord, their dear friend gives them peace. He shows them the evidence they need to calm their doubts. Then again, he gives them peace. What a beautiful gift. After all the turmoil and chaos that they've lived through in that last week, they surely need peace. And although Jesus knows they're afraid, he also knows they have work to do. They can't hide out forever. God sent Jesus to show them the way of the kingdom. And now that they have the gift of peace, they can hear the rest of his message and start to understand their mission. Their mission to bring the message of God's love to everyone, to take care of God's people. But it's not easy work. Sometimes it's hard, dangerous, heartbreaking work. But sometimes it's also exhilarating, joyous, soul-filling work. The disciples have a steep road ahead, but now they carry Jesus' peace with them. And Jesus brings them a second gift, the Holy Spirit. He knows that they also need the guidance of the Holy Spirit to help them figure out how to move forward. Now, the scripture tells us that not all the disciples are present on this first night. In particular, Thomas doesn't get to see Jesus at this appearance. The other disciples tell him about Jesus, and he wants to see for himself. He wants to see Jesus just like everyone else has gotten to. So we fast forward a week to find the disciples gathered again, and this time Thomas is with them, and Jesus comes again. What a gift. In the midst of so much fear and grief and confusion, Jesus comes to them, and the first thing he says to them again is, "Peace be with you." Simple, but so powerful words. And these words have no less power than they did 2,000 plus years ago. Jesus isn't greeting his friends just in the ancient world. Jesus' words transcend time and space. They greet us today. Peace be with you. take a moment. Breathe in those words. Let them fill you and fill your whole being. Because even when we don't feel peaceful, Jesus' peace is with us. It's in us, even though it's sometimes hard to access. It's always there. It's there in the joyful times. It's there in the sad times. It's there in the times filled with fear and worry. Peace be with you. Breathe in those words again, and then breathe them out. Breathe them out into the whole world. This is the peace of Christ, Jesus' good and loving gift. And this peace gives the followers of Jesus then and today the strength and courage to love and serve him, to carry the good news of God's love to everyone, to every creature in creation. This is the peace that we share with each other each time we gather to celebrate the Lord's Supper. These are the words that connect us. These are the words that carry Jesus' reassurance and comfort, the words that give us strength, and we share Christ's peace with others. And although we haven't just experienced the particular horror and gruesome events of the death and crucifixion of Jesus, we're living in uniquely difficult and uncertain times. We're in a heightened state of vigilance. We wonder, how, as Christians, can we live out Christ's message in the midst of a global pandemic? Then we remember that the disciples' gifts are ours too. Jesus has bestowed this gift upon us just as surely as he did the disciples. And as frightening and unpredictable as the news is from day to day, there are also remarkable stories of courage and love. People are using whatever resources they have to help each other. It may be sewing masks. It may be making sidewalk messages of hope. It may be delivering groceries to someone who can't be out. It may be singing songs to lift someone else's spirits. And it may be dance parties just to help us forget and enjoy the moment. In the midst of so much pain and suffering, we also have tremendous opportunity to share God's love, to help bring God's love and healing to a hurting world. And we can do it. It doesn't have to be a big gesture. If you can make a big gesture, great, do it. But if you can't, do what you can where you are. Meet the people where they are. That's all God asks of us. And Jesus' gift of peace gives us the strength and courage to share the good news. The best news. We are loved beyond imagination. And where love lives, so does hope. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. Who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, for Scott, our own bishop, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Creator are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, especially Donald, our president, Greg, our governor, and Betsy, our mayor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this diocese, for those who are present, and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health. Lord, hear our prayers for those we now name. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
And the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, be upon you and remain with you forever. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.